2020 has been a year filled with so much of uncertainties and limitations and the pandemic, and the list goes on. But in the midst of all these limitations, I think there's also been certain blessings. Don't you think so? For me personally, I think it's the first time I spent an entire summer with my family here. And I think that was a big blessing for my parents, at least, that, you know, they were able to spend.
Okay.
Yeah, and then the other blessing is this Zoom platform, isn't it? Like the virtual platform, even though we are from like different parts of the country, Cork, Sligo, Clonmel, Wicklow, Dublin, we're all able to come together here and listen to each other, connect with each other. And not only Ireland, we also have outside of Ireland joining us today. Any guesses? We have a very special person joining us all the way from India, joining us today. It is none other than our dearest George Devasi. George is one of the former GC Youth International Coordinators, and also he's one of the key resource persons in the GC Youth movement. I'm sure most of you guys met him before because he has been with us here in Ireland right from our early days of the movement, and he continues to be with us today as well. So it is both a blessing and a privilege for us to be sharing this space, this virtual space with George today. So George, I would like to welcome you on board to the JY Teens Air 9620.
Thank you. Yeah, good to be back digitally. Yeah,
yes, digitally.
Long time. Good. So how are you all doing?
We're doing good. Feel a bit sad that, you know, we have to go to schools with the masks on, but apart from that, everybody's doing good.
good. So I think I'll get into my responsibility ASAP, because I think Thomas sent me a lot of some of your questions, and I was totally taken up by those questions. I cannot imagine. I think you guys are teens. Are you teens? Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
It's a lot of wisdom for a teenager. You know? Some of the questions were really very intellectual, very deep, and the best sign of a smart person is somebody who asks questions. Okay. So I would have loved to go directly into the Q&A, but I think we'll just take a small introduction before we go into that. So just one request, all those who are on this call, if you could switch on your video, you know, because sometimes on digital platform, it's like, I know it's a little sad, you know, all those young, amazing people you can't see, you don't know whom you're talking to, yeah? So only if possible, yeah? It's not a requirement, only if you can, yeah? Because this digital platform is a big opportunity, but also has its own complications. I think I was leading an adoration in UK, and I was just praying, and during the adoration, I said, now let's spend some time in worship. And so everybody was silent. And suddenly I heard a sound, you know, Mindandirkira, ninnodale varanja Mindandirkira, you know, it was, and I was scared. I was like, did I do something wrong? Yeah? Did I not lead the adoration? Or maybe was it Jesus Christ, you know, suddenly speaking to me? Maybe he had enough of it, and he said, you know, George, I think you should not be doing this. But then I was sure it was not Jesus Christ, because it was a female voice. So I thought maybe it's Mother Mary or somebody else. And then I realized it was a mother who was trying to tell her kid to keep quiet. And but I was too scared. I immediately said, you know, now let's come to an end of this adoration. So, I know it's a little complicated, yeah, to do a digital session as such, and sometimes it's very tempting to multitask. I know your generation is known as Generation Z, if you know, yeah. You are a multitasking generation, so I know some of our prayer meetings have gone digital, and I can see some of the screens really freeze. So I know they are on an alternative application. I don't know about you, but in India, some of these teenagers get these tech devices only for spiritual purpose. So sometimes they are multitasking. So they have something spiritual going on one side, and then they have something unspiritual going on the other. other side. I don't know. I'm just guessing. I hope all of you are here with me. And we are, well, looking at the questions, I believe that you are quite a serious crowd. Are you? Yeah?
Oh, no.
We're only serious during the prayer meetings. Outside of meetings, we're all chill, isn't it?
I must not talk about serious, means serious, serious. Like you don't smile. I'm just talking about faith, because some of the questions that you ask need a lot of attention to understand, you know, the answer. So I can take this session in two ways, and I would take a vote on this because you are teenagers. Looking at your questions, I see that you are a very serious crowd, and we could take this Q&A or what we are going to discuss into a very intellectual level. You understand what I'm saying, yeah? Or maybe you just kind of a chill retreat crowd and you just want some entertainment. I can put some funny videos and some sharings, and then we can call it off, yeah? So would you, which one would you like to go for? You know, something serious. Now, when we say something serious, it's something serious. Yeah. You need to pay attention, yeah? Some of your questions are really complicated. So you need to understand salvation history and why God created, and you know, what went wrong, what's happening now. I know it's a very short time trying to cover all that. But I try my best if you are serious, yeah? I try my best if you really want to know. I was just a little bit of introduction about myself. I was born and brought up in a very Catholic, charismatic family. So I was taken to retreats at gunpoint. You understand what I'm saying, yeah? So I was forced to retreats. And I went to so many retreats and nothing happened to me. Obviously, I gave a tough time to the retreat preacher, and I was giving a good time to my friends, yeah? I was like the entertainer of the crowd. I can write a book about 1001 ways of creating trouble during the retreats. So, but I was not serious, you see. I never gave God a chance. So looking at the questions, I believe you are serious. So all those who think we go serious, can we have a thumbs up, yeah? We discuss creation, we discuss, a little bit of an intellectual dimension to why, how, yeah, atheists. Amazing questions. Okay, I see most of you would like to go for something like that. Yeah. Some of you still not responding. I think multitasking, maybe. I don't know, Netflix yeah. It's okay. You know, you're young and you should have the freedom. So we start with that, okay? So I would like to just start with a small introduction about God himself, because some of your questions revolve around who he is. Yeah? So I'll try to make it very simple. To make it very simple, I take the example of your parents. So do you all love your parents? I know you are teenagers. It's very difficult, but do you?
Yeah. Yes, George, most of the times.
Most of the times, yes, I know. I was a very troubled teenager, so I had a tough time, and there is a big generation gap. I was a migrant like you, so I had a tough time understanding. And I'm Malayali. I think most of you are Malayalis, I believe. Yeah, you look like, yeah. I'm sure you're Malayalis. So I was a migrant Malayali. Yeah. No Malayalis. Any non-Malayalis here? Yeah. Okay, yeah, so you can, so somebody is very sure about his identity. So, well, I was growing up in a migrant Malayali family, and there was a generation gap. There is all kinds of communication issues. You know, I'm saying something, my dad understands something else. He's saying something and I totally don't understand what he's saying. I just give you an example. The first time I asked for a bike from my dad, you know, and he started talking about his village life, and you know, when he was in his village, how he used to walk kilometers and kilometers, and there were cows and goats in his village, and he had only two shirts and two trousers, and now how I had three, you see. And so there was a big debate, and you know, as a teenager, the debate always goes heated. So my dad started saying, "You have no value for the tough life that we are living." Well, and they win. You see, I don't know. They always win. So, finally, I told my dad, "Okay, you do something. You get me a cow, okay? And if I go to the college or school with something like that." So, just look at the example of your parents and you. Yeah. So, there is a generation gap. You understand? Yeah. And they're talking about some village in Kerala, which is really out of the world, perfect place that they lived in. And, you know, I don't know, we moved into something really very abnormal. So, well, if you look at this, you will see there is a generation gap. And it's the same with God, who is our spiritual. I would say that there is a centuries of gap. It's not just a generation gap. It's a big gap. If you understand God as your spiritual parent, so to be able to communicate and to be able to understand God fully is a big challenge. So let's start with that. So many of us try to understand God and our relationship with the book of Genesis. I would say I'm sure we all have at least somewhere a conviction that our parents love us. Am I right? Yeah. Our parents love us. They love us. Otherwise, they would have never taken care of us. And I don't know. We need to be that messed up with that relationship that we believe that our parents really don't love us. But we know our parents love us. And we know our parents love us because of few things. One, they are our parents. Yeah. So that's number one. Number two is because there are a lot of signs in our life that we see that they are our parents because like they took care of us. I'm sure, you know, they send us to school. They provide everything that we need. And, you know, and also the third thing that you see that we know that our parents love us is also because they have plans for us. Well, most of the time, those plans don't match. Yeah, I know, you know, I don't know about you. Well, at least, I was just thinking, in a typical Indian family, their plans are either you to be an engineer or a doctor. I know my family also wanted me to be a doc, to actually become a doctor. And I went and wrote my medical entrance exam. Yeah. And it was an amazing exam because, in school, I was a great student. I used to get out of 100, 35, 35, 34 and a half, converted to 35. And I still remember I used to take my, you know, whatever you call it, yeah, the report card to my dad. And he would say, "How can you be so consistent? Not even a 36. And I used to say, "Yo, yeah." And that's me. Yeah, that's, you know, I was just consistent. So, and can you imagine somebody like me, they want me to write a medical entrance exam. And I obviously obliged, you know, they win finally. So I went and wrote the exam. I was the first to finish. Okay. Well, I had my revenge on all those fellows who were studying the whole year. And I could look at those. One guy looked at me like as if it was the end of the world. And he looked at me and he said, "Huh?" And I said, "Yeah, it was easy. I had time till the results were out, you see." So I could give it. So I came out. I gave my exams like, you know, like inky pinky ponky. And just it was. And well, I got my results. And my rank was a very special rank. It was really special because with that rank, you could know how many people wrote that exam. Because I think it was 25,000 something. And when I read the newspaper, they said that 25,000 something wrote the exam. So, I know plans, yeah? So parents have a plan and we have a plan. And there is always a little bit of a communication gap with that. And the same goes with God has a plan and we want to plan. So there is again a kind of a mismatch with that. So I just want to try to explain our relationship with God as a spiritual parent. And you can see the book of Genesis and you can understand a bit to what really happened in this relationship. See, if I were to come and tell you that, if I were to come and judge your relationship with your parents, it would be very difficult because I really don't know what was going on with you in your family all these years. It's the same between you and God. You know, it takes a bit of time to kind of understand that relationship. So I'm just going back to the book of Genesis. I'm sure you've read that story, and that is the sad part. Most of us read the book of Genesis like a story. If you see, the book of Genesis is not a story. Yeah, we'll have to look at it like a love story. Yeah, I know many of you youngsters might have heard about people falling in love. Yeah, any of you already fallen in love? Let me see. Okay. I think you're refraining from comments. So, well, nowadays young people, they say they have fallen in love, yeah, or they say that, Ellen Sijo. Can I see you? Yeah, Ellen Sijo, have you fallen in love before? Never? Yeah. You sure about that? Yeah. Okay. Ellen Sijo seems to be a very, somebody says a few times. Yeah, Noble Thomas. Can I see you? Yeah. Noble Thomas has fallen in love a few times. And I think you're still chatting with your girlfriends. No? Are you available for a short chat if you are not that busy? Because it's been quite times. Yeah, he says it's been a few times, fell quite hard. Okay. Really, he really fell down. Yeah. So people say, and trying to find sense out of a love letter would be nonsense. Yeah. I know young people write love letters. Nowadays, you don't write letters, you send messages. Yeah. So like I've seen young people write all kinds of weird things to each other. Like I'm going to bring the moon down for you and things like that. So I don't know if we can find scientific evidence, you know, I don't know if they're astronauts to bring moon down for you. And girls, by the way, you know, don't get carried away with all that. It's a lot of nonsensical comments trying to. I heard a guy tell a girl that, you know, I can do anything for you. And the girl replied, I think first you should start doing something for yourself. So before you start doing anything for me. Yeah. So, with all our limitations, we write love letters. Yeah. And even the love letters that we write as human beings with all our limitations seem to be very unscientific. So if you read the book of Genesis, it is a love letter written by God who has no limitations. So he tried to explain to us what actually happened during creation. So if you look at, and it is not an apple, it's not a tree, it's not a garden that the book of Genesis is talking about. It's talking about very symbolically what happened between God and man. So it's very simple. God loved us so much that he created us. And just like our parents, he created us with so much love that it was inevitable to give us freedom of choice. Yeah. If you see the book of Genesis, are you with me? Yeah. If you feel that this is a bit above the teenage level, I think Jeswin or Thomas, you could stop me and tell I can.
Sure, George. Yeah.
Go down to maybe make it milder. Yeah.
Sure.
Any of you guys, you could just text me, you know, in person. Yeah. It's okay. Can we go this level? Yeah. Good. Yeah, good. So because you have to pay a lot of attention. Yeah, we're trying to go into logic now. Yeah. So God created man. And if you see the Garden of Eden, it is symbolic to the harmony that existed in a perfect God's creation. That's what we are talking about, heaven. Yeah. So if you see, there are three types of harmony. There is harmony between man and God. That's why you will see that man did not need anything. There was perfect. There was one harmony, was harmony between man and God. That's why many a times when we sin, we lose that harmony. You know, if we are really in sin, I don't know about you. When you sin, then you don't like to pray. When you become more sinful, you don't want to go to church. When you really become really sinful, you don't want to go to a prayer meeting. And then when few sinful people get together, they all don't want to do anything regarding God. So that harmony, sin actually destroyed that one harmony. The second harmony was the harmony between man and man. Okay. So, well, we say man and woman. You see, the first game that Adam and Eve played was the blame game. Yeah. Eve blaming Adam, and Adam trying to blame, you know, they're trying to blame the snake. And even today, we are always going into that. We are playing the same game. If you see husbands and wives, I don't know about you. Sometimes my house, my parents used to, you know, have a lot of interesting battles at home. And I don't know about you, at least in my case, my parents used to, whenever they had a debate, you know, I always say that my mom used to, my dad used to shoot once in a while. Like, you know, he would say, oh, this tea is not good. Or, you know, or this curry is not good. Or sambar is not good. And my mom used to collect all that. And maybe, you know, 1991, 1993, 94. And then in 1995, you know, the big bazooka, and there was a big battle. Yeah, you told me that, and you told me that. And we used to be like prisoners of war. I remember if there was a conflict at home, I would be doing all my homework because I know that they're going to come after me soon. Yeah. So anyways, I don't know, but you guys might be living in very peaceful families. It was not my case. So there is disharmony between man and man. They start fighting. Even today, if you read, it's all this disharmony, yeah, from the beginning. And then there is disharmony between man and nature. If you see the coronavirus, yeah, if you see most of the situation today, one young man asked me, I do a lot of Q&A with youngsters, especially with youth, not exactly with teenagers, but I'm happy that now I have teenagers who can, you know, we can find some, you know, some serious discussion with. So they asked me, where is God during coronavirus? And I said, I see only God during coronavirus, because the doctors have lost it, the scientists have lost it, the countries have lost it, the RBI, as the financial systems have lost it. It's, I see there is only God that could, you know, do something about it. So what I'm trying to say, the disharmony between man and nature. Man started, if you read the book of Genesis, you will read that man was given dominion over nature. Are you with me? Yeah. You know, if you lose me, you can tell me, you know, George, slow down. Are you with me? Yeah. So God gave man dominion over nature. That means what? Nature was supposed to be obedient to man. That means you go and tell a lion, if Adam and Eve were to go and tell a lion to sit down, the lion would sit down. Yeah. If you go and tell a lion today to sit down, I don't know. Yeah. It should be in a cage for sure. Or maybe if you tell the lion to sit down, maybe the lion may sit down and say grace before meals. Bless us, O Lord, in these thy gifts, which we are about to receive from thy bounty. Yeah. So sin, you see, that God's first great sign of creation was love. That is, he created us with great freedom, but we misuse that freedom. Yeah. And when we misuse that freedom, three harmonies were lost: between man and God, between man and man, between man and nature. Even today we are fighting. You know, a lot of these funny atheists, they blame God for the disharmony between that we have caused with nature. God did not create disharmony with nature. You see, even the scientists agree that, you know, the floods, the earthquakes, all kinds of mess that we see today, a lot of it has to do with the battle between man and nature. Man trying to attack nature and nature responding. Yeah, because when you are in sin, you lose that dominion. You know, if you read the life of Saint Francis of Assisi, he used to live in the jungle and the wild animals used to obey him. You know, if we are at a level to which we are in harmony with God, actually nature is supposed to be obedient to man. Okay, so I'm just trying to, just like between us and our parents, God created us. The first sign of love was creation. Beautiful creation. He said, you have everything you need. The only thing is you should not eat the apple. It was not an apple. What was that apple? Which tree? Let me see. Which tree? Do you remember which tree? Which tree? What was the name of the tree? Yeah? Any of you went to catechism classes or something like that?
Most of us went to 12 years of catechism class, Chetan, and still not a clue.
Amazing, yes. Okay, Ellen says, the knowledge of good and evil, tree of good and evil, tree of knowledge. Okay, Rahul says tree of knowledge. Okay, very good. I see very serious guys in this group. Good. In the beginning, I saw some funny messages, but now I see you are back to track, yeah? So, great. You will see God. Understand the logic. God says, you know, that's what sometimes parents tell the kids, yeah? See, you have a house, you have food, you have education, you have everything. Why do you need that one friend, yeah? You know, you have everything you need. Why do you need that video game? Why do you need that that phone, yeah? Why do you want that extra bit, yeah? You are surely going to get married. We are going to get you married, arranged marriage with some Malayali. Why do you want this boyfriend? So you will see, yeah, you will see it's something similar. What happens is God is telling Adam and Eve, you have everything. Everything is perfect here. There is harmony. Only one thing is that if I really love you and you are my child, I have to give you freedom of choice. Otherwise, you will be slaves. Now, in this freedom of choice, the only thing that you don't need, but you can choose. Are you with me? Are you with me? You don't need. Can you repeat after me? You don't need.
You don't need.
But you can choose.
But you can choose.
Because you are a child.
Because you are a child.
Is the knowledge of good and evil. Is the knowledge of good and evil. You see, what a loving father. What a loving father. You know, actually, God could have created us like robots. Yeah. Simple. Okay. Or God could have created us like animals. They don't have full freedom of choice. They are not self-aware. Yeah. God could have created us, if God would have created us robots, we might be all saying, hallelujah, praise the Lord, hallelujah, praise the Lord, 24/7. We had no choice. Yeah. But God was love and God wanted us to be children, not slaves. So it was inevitable to give us a perfect heaven with the freedom to know that there is an apple, there is a tree, there is a scenario. Are you with me? There is a scenario where you can have the capability to know good and evil. Till that scenario, you wouldn't know evil. Are you with me? Yeah. But what did man do? Man said, no, I want to misuse this freedom. Yeah. Every time we misuse our freedom, okay, is when I think who's Dylan Jam? I think putting some messages into the group. Jasmine, Can you take care of that? Yeah.
Yeah, sure, Chata. I'll sort it out.
I see. Okay. Dylan, you want to talk to me? You want to ask some questions? Is it? Is that what you mean? Yeah. Well, Jasmine, let's be very democratic. Yeah. If there is any, there's a Q&A time. There's a Q&A. We will ask. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. So we'll be having a time towards the end where everybody can open up and ask Chetan the questions, George the questions. So if we can just refrain from infiltrating the chat box now, that'd be great.
I just go back to what I was trying to say before, is that, we need to pay serious attention. You know, some of the atheists, are like funny kids, yeah? You know what they do? I debate with a lot of atheists, and some of them come up to me and they start debating, and I ask them. So they said, I've read this, I've read the evolution theory, I've read Da Vinci, I've read this, I've read that, I've read Dan Brown, I've read this, that. And then I ask them, have you read the Bible? No. They have not read the Bible, you see. So I'm just trying to give you an overview of what God has to say. It is very important to know what God has to say. Otherwise, we will be listening to a lot of people, what others have to say, and we wouldn't come to the truth. Okay, so I go back to where I am now. So God created us with absolutely no error. Now, some people ask, why does God give us freedom to do error? It is inevitable that you had. So what happened? As soon as the apple was bad, what is the symbolism? The symbolism is that basically the harmony was lost. Now, did God give up? No. God came back, salvation history. He died for us and he fixed the problem. But again, he cannot fix the problem of freedom of choice. As soon as freedom of choice is taken away, we are not child. We are a slave. Now, God knew exactly that this, freedom of choice that we are talking about, if it is fully taken away, okay, there's a problem. So he said, he sent the Holy Spirit. So if you look at where we stand today, God has done everything. God has done everything possible. I think nobody's loved us the way God has loved us. God has given us everything. He's done everything possible to help us. So it's only a matter of me trying to understand it. So I just want to give a small overview of the salvation history, and we can go into Q&A. I see a lot of people very, very curious to get into Q&A. So I think Jasmine will go into Q&A.
Sure, Jada. Sure. Yeah. So thank you so much, Josh, for that introduction. So before we came for the webinar, the youth team had sent you guys a questionnaire, right? So most of you guys had responded. So based on the questions, we basically clubbed them into different sections. And on your behalf, we will be asking George those questions. And after that, we'll be having a time where the floor will be open for all of you guys, and anybody can ask questions to George. So for the next few minutes, we'll be focusing on the questions that came in through the questionnaire. Okay, great. And so now George is going to be introducing the first section, and he'll be talking about the first question as well. Giorgio? Okay, anyway, so the first question or the first section was God's existence. So there were many questions related to God's existence. And the first question that came up was, is there any undeniable proof that God exists? As you mentioned, George, before, without any reference to the Bible. So there's many questions about, you know, how can we prove that God exists? Bible is written by religious people, so obviously it could be biased. So what is your thoughts on that question?
Well, I can answer this question. Well, all the questions we'll answer in two ways. Yeah. One is the spiritual way. The other is the logical way. Yeah. I am sure they're more interested on the logical side, but let's also look at the spiritual dimension. Well, the spiritual dimension is very simple. The answer is very simple. I believe that God exists because I have experienced God. Okay. If I were to ask you, do you believe your parents exist? I'm sure that your answer will be very, you will be like shocked, and you'll say, what kind of a weird question is that? I see them every day. Yeah. I talk to them every day, and I have I'm interacting with them every day. So it's obviously, so all those who have really experienced God in their life, I'm sure they don't need any scientific proof. Okay. And I would say it will be really demeaning God in many ways to try to go for scientific proof, but we still want, you know, we still should go for it. I'm not against it, but I'm just saying, like, it would be like telling your parents, you know, I'm not sure you're my parents. Let's do a DNA test. Yeah. So, you know, it's because we have been seeing signs and the reality. See, whenever you want to prove that somebody loves you, okay, the evidence is the act of love that that God has done for us. Yeah, the act of love that person has done for us. All these. So, this would be a very personal spiritual answer, I would say, and I would challenge each one of you. You are teenagers. You know, I can tell you, it's absolutely very important that you give God a chance. I can tell you, myself, I went for so many retreats, and I was, you know, see, when you, there are different ways of approaching God. There were different ways of approaching God. Say, like, for example, I had a very wrong way of approaching God, because I was brought up in a very Catholic charismatic family, and I was very averse to this kind of praising and thanking God and all that. So, and I had my own difference of opinion with my parents. So I used to approach God with rebellion. Okay. Like I remember I was wasting so many of my retreats. A good example would be, you know, I used to go for retreats and crack jokes, create trouble. So that is a rebellious way of trying to approach God. And it is very difficult. And I made a fool out of myself. Many of you might have also gone to retreats and trying to create trouble. Actually, you know, you don't make a hero out of yourself. You actually make a fool out of yourself. You know, the friends that are trying to encourage you, actually, they are also, for them also, you're just a funny guy. Yeah. So in the bargain, you kind of, I see in some ways, some of these people who are like me, who are trying to rebel God, were people who had no self-control. Yeah. So I think the first and foremost thing to be able to experience God is a personal experience with God is to give God a chance. Give God a chance. And I still remember I went for an adoration, and that one retreat, there was one preacher. I don't know what he had against me. He used to keep coming to me and looking at my face and say, give God a chance, give God a chance. And I was like, why me? You know, I thought he had something against me. And during that adoration, I still remember I was, and we'll come to that soon, the peer pressure thing. You know, for me, peer pressure was everything. So I wanted to be a big shot in front of my friends, and I didn't want to show them that I'm really, really spiritual. So I used to always create some fun and trouble and all kinds of things so that I get recognized. But actually, I was a fool. Yeah, I was like a, so most important is not to rebel. Give God a chance. If you give God a chance, and I remember that adoration, I really had God touch me. If you ask me, I had a personal experience with God. Then I needed no scientific proof. And do you know, experience with God is not far away. You don't need any qualification for that experience. And every human being who has experienced God has no doubt about God's existence. Why do you think this Jesus youth is going on? Why do you think Jesswin or all these people who are trying to organize all these things, they have other thousand things to do. Why are they doing this for all of you? Because they have experienced God in person. Now, when you experience God, the experience is not same as experiencing another human being, because he's God. First of all, he's not physical. Please understand. You know, when I say that I have experienced somebody, it's like the wind. Yeah. It's like the wind. You know, if somebody were to say, explain my relationship with wind to my relationship with another human being, and try to say that wind does not exist, you get what I'm trying to say? Yeah. These are totally two different types of relationship. That means this is a relationship between a human being and another human being. Another thing is a relationship between a human being and wind, yeah, which is a completely, in the same way, it is one big mistake we do in science is we try to compare two physical relationships with one relationship between somebody who is physical like us to somebody who is supernatural. So if you ask me, did you have a coffee with Jesus Christ? You know, I wouldn't say that would be the right evidence to prove God exists. Yeah. If somebody says that, or did Jesus hug you? Did you ever shake your hands with Jesus? I would say yes, but spiritually. Yeah. So one of the biggest problems with biggest conflict between science and spirituality is that science tries to prove something physically, whereas spirituality tries to prove something with experience. And again, history itself can be only proven with historical evidence. If Jesus was not real, I can tell you a little bit about myself. There was a point in time I studied, I researched, I stopped believing in God. I studied religion, other religion. I studied Hinduism, I studied Islam and all these things. And I studied a lot of history. And then I finally came to this conclusion that other than Jesus Christ, true God, true man, nobody in history has been supernaturally proven like Jesus Christ. And I can go on and on with those evidence. If you've been to Israel, you would know. If you've been to the Holy Land, yeah? There's again and again centuries of evidence that God's intervention in man's life, God's intervention in different forms in man's life. And sometimes we don't want to accept it because though God is intervening, we just want to say that God does not exist. I'll give you an example. That's what many of the atheists do. You know, I give this example for an atheist. Imagine there was a father who was a PhD in mathematics. Are you with me? Yeah. A father who was a PhD in mathematics. Okay. And he had a son who was in grade 2. Yeah. Just starting mathematics. Now, if the son who is studying grade 2 mathematics goes to the father who is the PhD. You know what's a PhD? Yeah. He's a doctorate in mathematics. Goes and tells the father, I want to know everything that you know now. What would you tell that son? Let's talk to each other. Can you? Yeah. Jeswin or somebody?
Yeah, surely. I think, you know, if I was in that position, I would say, you know, you need to wait because you're not ready to observe all of that right now.
Okay, let's do a role play here. Okay, let's do a role play here. You know, I like Noble. Yeah, Noble, are you with me? I hope you're not too busy. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, Noble. Let's do a role play here. Okay. Okay, Ellen, you won. Ellen, can you also unmute? Yeah, I think I have made two good friends here. Yeah, Ellen Noble. Okay, Noble, you are the PhD father. Okay, and Ellen, you are the grade 2 kid. Yeah, who wants to know everything about mathematics? Can you ask your father? Let's have a conversation.
Dad, I need to know everything you know about maths. Quickly.
Noble, try to convince him.
No, I want to.
Wait a few seconds, let me get the belt. Son, there's no way you can learn what I've learned in the last 20 years in the next 12.
I can, I'm really smart. Look at this. 2 plus 2 is 4. Minus 1, that's 3 quick maths. There. Whoa, now you can teach me. There. So, can you teach me now? Can you teach me? Please? Pretty please?
Why are I you think being... Dad got scared by the 2 plus 2.
I think
you can't argue with that.
Yeah.
I think...
It's beyond human comprehension.
I think that Dad logged off. Yeah. Logged out of it. Okay, Jasmine, Ellen, sure. Can you talk to Jasmine, yeah? Try to convince.
All right, son. What's up?
I want to learn maths.
Okay, that's good. So where do you want to start first?
I want to start everywhere. I want to learn everything.
You want to learn everywhere, okay. That's a nice, interesting statement, but it's like, you know, trying to swim an ocean even before you swam a pool. So I would say start at the baby pool first. Start to learn to float, maybe. So maybe we can start with the multiplication tables first.
Can we start with, like, the PhD stuff?
But I can explain you all the PhD stuff, but, you know, you are able to comprehend it right now.
I think I will be able to, don't you think?
Okay, so let's start with Stokes' theorem, yeah?
Yes.
So, in Stokes' theorem, do you know what Stokes' theorem is?
No clue.
Ah, so in order to understand Stokes' theorem, you need to understand calculus. Do you know calculus?
No idea.
Okay, so understand calculus, you need to start with algebra. Do you know, like, multivariate algebra?
Yeah, I think so. I think I learned that in school last year.
Multivariate algebra, not grade 2 algebra.
I think so.
Okay,
Jasmine, I am Ellen's brother. I am also joining him. Ellen, you know, Ellen, keep going, yeah?
Yeah.
Useless dad, yeah?
Yes. Yes.
What do you think, Ellen, yeah? He doesn't love us, yeah? If he really loved us, how selfish, he knows everything, doesn't want to tell us, isn't it, Ellen?
Yeah, that's so unfair.
Yeah, a useless father. Yeah, he doesn't love us anymore. It's not love. Yeah, all that he did from our childhood was just waste, yeah?
Absolutely
useless. Okay, yeah, Ellen, let's do something, man. Let's chuck this guy out, yeah? Let's leave. Let's run away from home. Let's do that, yeah?
Okay.
Yeah, we may find some
person that will teach us proper
maths. Who could teach us, PhD suddenly, like Satan. We'll get somebody else doing that job, yeah? Jasmine, useless father, get lost, okay? You don't love us, yeah? You see?
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you, Ellen. You're a pro, man.
Yeah,
let's go, boys. Let's go.
Go, Ellen. Let's go. Okay. So, thank you, Noble and Ellen and Jasmine. What I'm trying to say is that the atheists are like this. Yeah? They go to God. You're talking about the creator of the universe. Yeah? You go to God. Yeah? And you go and tell God, I want to know everything that you know. And God says, wait. Yeah? It takes time. Okay? I love you. But you know what the atheists say? Oh, you know what? God doesn't love us. God doesn't exist. Why is God doing this? You know, I want to know everything now. And they leave home. That's what they are called. Yeah, they are atheists. They leave home. Okay? Cool. So, I'm just getting back to the evidence of God. So the evidence, there is scientific evidence, but surely the scientific evidence is not all physical, because we are talking about a supernatural God, but we still do have physical manifestations of God. Again and again, centuries and centuries, we have been seeing the same God work miracles after miracles. Yeah. And there is, you know, you go to these retreat centers, a retreat would have... And I never believed in many of these miracles till I personally started experiencing those miracles in my life. So there is so much of scientific evidence. There is so much of spiritual evidence. So God is existing. The only thing that we can do is keep fooling ourselves by saying that he does not exist. It's like sometimes trying to debate with the Protestants. Yeah, you go and tell a Protestant that we don't worship Mother Mary. And they will say, no, you worship Mother Mary. No, we don't worship Mother Mary. No, you worship Mother Mary. You worship Mother Mary. What can we do? Yeah, they just don't want to accept it. So, if you keep on want to denying God, then there's nothing we can do about it. Yeah. So good. Next question. Yeah, I know a lot of questions are there. Let's go for it. Yeah.
Jetta, so let me get this. Sorry. So you said God is, he knows everything. So, and he is the creator. He is amazing. So, if he's so good and so amazing, like, it's impossible to put him within our human knowledge and try to explain him within our human knowledge, if I'm getting this right. So if that's the case, then, and we also know that faith and reason also go hand in hand. So if that's also the case, then what about things like in science, like Big Bang Theory, evolution, and all of that? Does that, you know, like the knowledge is also what God has given us. And with that knowledge, we came up with these things through science, Big Bang Theory and evolution and stuff. Does that have any place in how God created the world? Does it go in line with like the story of creation? What's the story with that?
It's a wonderful question, a very common question. And I would need a lot of time to go into the theory itself, but I just try to give an overview because I know that you have so many other questions with other subjects as well. Yeah. So I very fast trying to give you some examples. Okay. So see, we are talking about two theories here. Yeah. One is the theory called God. Yeah. In the previous example, as you see, this is a PhD theory. Okay. And then we are talking about science, which is like going from first standard to second standard to third standard to fourth standard. See, man is just actually evolving to that theory. You see, so when a superior theory is given to us in love, and the inferior theory, I don't want to use the word inferior because it is maybe sometimes not very respectable towards the scientists, but I'm just saying, we have a theory with a lot of limitations because it is made by human beings who have a lot of limitations. Yeah. They die to start with. Okay. Let's look at the best example of coronavirus. Yeah. You see the COVID-19, it's been almost a year. We're still struggling with it. Okay. The science of the world is not able to solve this, such a small problem. Okay. So the syllabus of God trying God's or let us look at the Bible itself. Yeah. The syllabus of the Bible is salvation of man. Okay. And that theory is only dealing with the salvation of man because God might be thinking that that is the only theory that we need to know at this point of time. But science is slowly, it's an evolving theory. The evolution theory itself has been proven, disproven, proven, disproven. So basically, I give you a good example, you know, few days back, I read a theory by one of the scientists who says that it is good to smoke. Yeah, he has his own theory. I don't know. I don't know. Many youngsters would have been very happy with this, but I'm just saying, yeah. So I read after this pandemic, there have been so many theories about what we should be doing about preventing COVID-19. Yeah. Including our prime minister in India says that you can use sound to keep it away. Yeah. Yeah. You will see the inferior science is trying to do so many things and then proving, disproving, proving, disproving. So what I'm trying to say is that when you compare these two theories, this theory, because we are not intellectually up to it, we need faith. Whereas this theory, because it is coming from our own intellect, all that we need is our intellect. Are you with me? I don't want to take it too high. Is it okay?
It's okay, Shatta. I think it's manageable.
Okay. So science is not wrong, but can be wrong once in a while, then evolve in its own. But God is perfect. Yeah. So first of all, the biggest mistake we can do with the evolution theory is trying to say that the book of Genesis is talking about the evolution. The book of Genesis is not talking about evolution, my friends. Yeah. The church never said it. Like the Protestants trying to keep on saying repeating this. The book of Genesis is not talking about evolution. The book of Genesis is talking about few facts that God wants to communicate with us very creatively. What are those facts? Number one, that God was the only existing in the beginning. Second, that God created us. Third, that God created us with great love, and God created everything else also. And the most important, that man is the most important creation. It's not talking about evolution theory. How can you compare two theories which are not talking about the same thing? You see, Darwin's theory is talking about evolution. Book of Genesis is not talking about evolution. Bible does not want to talk about evolution. Bible wants to talk about salvation. Are you with me? Yeah. So the atheists are trying to compare two theories which are not You know, you're trying to use mathematics to disprove biology. Yeah? It's two different theories, yeah, altogether. So science in itself might be true, might be wrong. But God in itself is always correct. And he has always, so science, we are not saying that we should not believe in science, but because science is always evolving, it should not be the end of our knowledge. We should always depend on, like the third year kid should always believe that one day he would know everything. That does not mean that he thinks that he should be stuck with grade three. Okay. So I don't want to go into those theories because I think we are short of time. But by the way, you guys can contact me anytime. You know, those who are really interested in theories and discussions, I would love to do that. I love to spend time with them. Yeah. Okay. Jasmine, next. Yeah.
Yeah. So Thomas has the next question.
Okay. The next question is a very popular question. We had a lot of questions on this one. It's about suffering. Okay. So the question is, why does God let bad things happen to good people? Or, you know, why are people close to him, close to God, seems to suffer a lot? How is suffering part of God's plan?
Okay. So it's a, first let me say, who do you think is good and bad? How many of you think that you are good? Could you just... Yeah. Alvin thinks he's good. Yeah. Who else?
Alan also thinks he's good.
Okay, Alan thinks he's good. Yeah. Okay, how many of you think you are bad? You will see that we in some ways already answered the question, yeah? See, even we don't know if we are good or bad, yeah? So how can we say that it is being good or bad that things happen to us, okay? Or sufferings happen to us or whatever happens to us. So let's first start to understand this question from God's perspective. Now we are looking at it, our perspective. What is our perspective? Our perspective is only the 80-90 years that we are going to live on this earth. Am I right? Any of you going for a century? Yeah. Good. Alan is going for it. I hope, you know, my sincere best wishes in this. I don't know after COVID-19 was the next one. But let's be very optimistic and we say we're going to live 100 years on earth. The problem is our perspective of suffering is only the 100 years. If you look at a graph of your soul, your life on earth is 100 years. But how many years does your soul live?
Forever?
Forever. Let's try to... What is the biggest number you know?
A trillion.
Okay, somebody said infinity. Okay, let's look at a trillion, yeah? So, please be with me, okay? Please be with me. If you understand this, I think you'll understand a lot of these questions very easily. And how does God look at us? See, we're talking about, you know, I'm going to live trillion years. So what is more important for me? What happens to me in the 100 years? Or what should happen to me a trillion minus 100? What do you think? Yeah. So the problem is we are looking at 100 years. God is looking at a trillion years. Okay. So when we say we are suffering, when we say that we are in pain, when we say that maybe I have cancer, when we say that, oh no, I'm going to die. When we say any of these things, what we are saying is that we are talking about the 100 years or the 50 or the 60 or the 70 or the 80 years we are talking about. But when God is looking at us, God is preparing us. God wants us for a trillion years. I think the right word would be a million years or infinity. So if you look at all that happens to us in this 100 years, that is the reason why the saints had an eternal perspective to their life. When you have an eternal perspective to your life, you see this suffering also as a joy. I'll give you an example. A lot of these saints, they were beaten, they were kicked, they were killed, and they were smiling. They were smiling. They, you know, there is a beautiful scenario where a saint was like, look at, and they used to live in style. I would say a person who has understood the eternal perspective would live in style. Yeah. Many of you are looking at style with, I don't know what. Many of you are looking at, many of you like Marvel. Yeah. You like Avengers and all these things, which, you know, you like superheroes who don't exist. I think Jesus is the only existential superhero. Are you with me? Yeah. You see, but media doesn't promote him anymore. We are so crazy about non-existing superheroes. See, please understand, all these superhero stories that you look at, you will see they are all talking about something supernatural. Yeah. And so God is actually focused on our soul than our body. God is more focused. So whatever sufferings that we go through, if it is going to help us to improve the situation of our soul, I would say that is the greatest blessing you could have. That is the greatest blessing you could have. And God is allowing that to happen. God is allowing that to happen because he knows that even though it is just a little bit of suffering, I am sure that this will help this person to be with me forever. You know, it's like if you take your child to a hospital and he says that, oh, I don't want this, I don't want this medicine. And what does the parent say? Oh, I know it's a little bit of trouble for you with this injection. It's a little bit of trouble for you, but it is so that you live with us happily. Yeah. So if you see from an eternal perspective, please understand that all those sufferings that we see are not going to be forever. The only permanent suffering you can have is hell. Are you with me? Okay. And somebody asked me, what is the definition of hell? And I said something, my answer would be, the furthest way you can go away from God's plan, that place is hell. Are you with me? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So, you know, don't look at suffering as something permanent. I would say sin is something that we need to fight. And some of us get it wrong, you know. What is more dangerous? Somebody who is dying of cancer or somebody who is dying in sin? Who is in a greater risk?
Dying in sin, because like after that they have to go to an eternity in hell, I think.
Yeah, so they are losing a trillion years, am I right?
Yeah.
Now, look at it logically. You have a friend who is in sin and you have another friend who is suffering from cancer. With whom should you be more sympathetic?
Suffering in sin. Dying in sin.
Both?
I don't want to be an idealist. I would say we should be equally sympathetic to both. Yeah. But then I would say that today's world is more sympathetic towards the cancer patient, but is least bothered about somebody who is in sin. You have a friend who is alcoholic. Good. Drink. Let's do it. Somebody, you have a friend who is like, you know, addicted to pornography. Like, whoa, man. Which one did you see today? Yeah. It's like, you know, oh, wow. It's like, you know, and some of us like, you know, we have just created this world as an encouragement for the greater suffering that is sin. What do you think is a greater suffering? A painful disease or sin? You're smart kids, tell me.
Sin.
And you know, Satan, you know how smart Satan is? Satan just does not want you to think about it. He wants you to think about all the other things, but does not want you to think about the greatest problem on this planet, that is sin. That sin that brought disharmony, that sin that killed everything, that sin that took nature against us. You know, we don't want to talk about it. We want to talk about, a lot of things. And it's so sad. Young people, you know, Satan is going after you guys and is constantly telling you that the real suffering is something else. The real suffering is sin. And I see sometimes, I feel sad about a lot of young people. I went to a pub recently. I was invited by, not recently, you know, shortly before COVID-19. And I don't want to die. So I was there, and it was a business meeting, and it happened there, you know, I think it was sometime long time back. And I could see young people, you know, they are so happy with sin. You know, there's a guy who is doing the, you know, what do you call him? DJ, yeah?
Yeah, DJ.
He's making some dosha up there, and you know, the youngsters are drinking, and some of them are on drugs. And then this one girl looked at me and said, "Hey." Sad, you see? And look at the guy. He thinks he's doing something great, you see? I'm not against DJs. I'm saying, yeah? And he's looking at me and saying, like, "Come on, yo. Do it, man." See, we are misguided. We think, I'm not against partying. I'm not against music or DJing or anything like that. But what I'm trying to say is that in between all these things, you will see Satan trying to incorporate the real suffering that is sin. Sin is the real suffering, yeah? You eat food, God gives good. Eat too much, gluttony. Suffering, yeah? You want to rest, good. God created rest. Rest too much, laziness, suffering. Lazy man suffers. You are supposed to take care of yourself. You take care of yourself too much, selfishness, jealousy, suffering. You see? You want to, man and woman, is it attracting? Do man and women attract? Yeah, you should attract. Yes, no attraction, something's wrong. So, attraction, but too much attraction, lust, suffering. Yeah. Please understand, you see, we going away from... So, a brilliant question. I would say, I'm not worried about any of the suffering. The only suffering I am worried about is sin. I'm sure God is only worried about that. Because he knows that he has a solution to everything else. But sin is our choice. We have manufactured it in joint venture with Satan. You guys are lovely. Yeah, I know. It's very good questions. Keep going. Yeah, I know we've short of time. Let's take some last few questions. Yeah.
Yes. So Kiran's next. Kiran.
Yeah. So Chatter, our next question is about free will. So earlier you mentioned that God didn't create us as robots. He has given us, you know, the freedom to make our own choices. So the question is, if God isn't responsible for our actions, then what actually is God's involvement in our lives?
Okay. Kiran, how are you doing? Yeah, you fine?
Yes. Yeah, I'm good, Chetra. Good to see you.
Good, yes. So, I met Kiran last time in Calgary, yeah? You know?
Yeah. Okay.
Good.
In a few years.
So, the answer is very simple. God has to do with everything. You understand, yeah? God has to do with everything. And God is the owner of everything. He's responsible for everything. The only thing that he does not go out of his way into is our freedom of choice. Okay? So, for example, I give you one example. Maybe not the best example, but just try to explain to you. Imagine that in a room there is a father and a child. And the child says, "I want light." And the father lights a candle and tells the child that this candle is for you, the light is for you, the room is for you. Enjoy. The only thing you should not be doing is putting your finger into the fire. Everything is me. The light is me, the candle is me, the room is me, everything is me. The only thing is, don't put your finger into the candle. It'll burn you. Are you with me? Yeah. Now, if the child still goes and puts the finger into the candle, flame, whom do you blame? The child. Yeah. So you don't blame the father who gave the child light. Yeah. You don't blame the father who gave the child the room. You don't blame the father the toys he gave the child in the room. You don't blame the father who created food for the child in the room. You don't blame the father. That's not logical. But that's what atheists do, yeah? So, everything is God. It was a wonderful question. Everything is God. plan is God, the action is God, the creation is God, everything is God. Only the freedom of choice is given to us because he loves us. Now, after the child puts the finger into the candle, what's going to happen? The finger is going to be burnt. Now, a human father, what does he do? He says, I'm not responsible. You know, Malayali father will say, that's what the father is going to say. But God is not like that. God says, did you burn your finger? Okay, I am God. I'm going to fix it. But please come back to me. Are you with me? You sinned. You brought all this suffering onto you. Don't worry. I'm going to take all that suffering onto myself. But please come back to me. This is the sad part of the cross. Yeah, he came, he died, he took away all our sins. But what are we doing? We are going back to sin. We are going again and again. So if you ask me what is man's role and God's role was number one, give us everything and said, you don't need to know the knowledge of good and bad. Man said, no, over smart. I will go and do it. Then what God said, okay, you burnt your hand, fine. I'm going to come die for you, take it away. All the consequence. He did that. After he died and he rose again and he's destroyed sin, what are we saying? No. I still want to sin. Then God says, oh, fed up of these fellows. So let's give him the Holy Spirit. So Holy Spirit will tell what is right and wrong. Now what are we saying? No, Holy Spirit, no retreat. Oh, I don't like prayer. I don't like to pray. The Bible is boring. I love Satan. Now, will you tell me what is God's role? God is doing everything possible. Well, we are doing everything possible to go away from him. But all those who are not doing it are coming closer to God and you can see miracles in their life. The saints, look at the life of the saints. Look at the church. Look at all the beautiful people that we see around. Once you accept Jesus, how beautiful your life will be. All you need to do is to jump that barricade. Yeah, Satan has put. And that barricade is the barricade of ignorance of God. I'm very happy you guys are here and asking questions. You should ask questions, yeah? And you should jump the barricade. Give him a hard time. This Satan, that fellow is real, drama queen, you know? He come and first he'll come and make you sin, okay? Satan, that fellow is real drama queen. He'll come and make you sin. And then after you sin, you are like, oh, I'm a sinner. Now, how can I go to God? Then he'll say, yeah, see, you are a sinner. You cannot go to God. And then you'll make him more and more and more. Don't go to him. Don't listen to him. Yeah. So, Kiran, your question, I can just summarize saying that it's all about God. The only thing we need to give is allow God to take control of our life. Please trust him. He has the best CV. What do you call it? CV in Ireland? Yeah.
Yeah, sir, CV.
Yeah, he's got the best CV to take care of you. Not even, it's the best CV ever. Better than your friends, your parents, your society, anybody. Why don't you give your life to him? So good question. Yes. One last, is it Jasmine? I think we're running out of time.
Yeah, we're running out of time. I think there's two or three more questions. Kiran, are you going to ask?
I hope, guys, I'm not, giving you, making it, I hope you're okay. Yeah.
Definitely, Chetan. I think everybody is really interested. And these are the questions that, we face every day, even when we go to school and we interact with our friends, especially the Irish crowd. So it's definitely insightful for all of us.
Yeah. Okay, good.
Okay, so next question is from Roshan. Next question is from Roshan. Roshan, are you ready?
Yeah. So I just wanted to ask, do we need to have an organized religion to lead a good life? In the sense that, do we need to be part of a Catholicism or anything to lead a good life? Is it not good enough to just be a good person who does good? Do I need to have faith to have morals as such? This is the question that I have.
Yeah, good question. I would like, again, like any other question, want to answer it logically and also spiritually. Okay. So to answer it logically, let me ask you a question. Do you need a school to be educated? It can be any school. It can be a home school also. But do you need a school for education?
Yes.
I can get you the best books. I can get you everything that you need. No human beings around. You locked up in a room. Okay. Give you the best resources that you have possible ever. After you graduate, will you be educated?
I suppose you need someone to teach.
You will see. We are created. You see, first we need to understand our creation. we are created. Let's start with the basics first. We are a creation of love. What does love mean? We are a creation who takes love and gives love. Okay? That's how God is. God is actually Trinitarian love. The Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. They are in perfect love with each other. And when they created us, we were also created in that perfect love. Yeah, we are supposed to love each other. And no matter what, you know, sometimes some guys come and say, I'm a macho man. I don't love. Yeah, no emotions. Yeah, I'm strong. And maybe you've watched a few stupid Hollywood movies and you think you're very strong. No, 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 no. When you are in trouble, you cry like a baby. I know that. Yeah, guys, let's face it. And some of the girls might say that, you know, we are very stable. Huh? You know, we don't need any love. Yeah, I hate men. Okay, so I know all kinds of theories. You know, from where? Yeah, feminism. I don't know. I'm not against feminism. Don't sue me for this. I'm very scared doing programs in first world countries. You don't know what you're going to sue me for. So, Jasmin, are you recording this? Please stop recording all this because you never know.
We'll make sure the daylight doesn't see this.
So, well, I'm just trying to say that, you know, you should know that we are a creation of love. Yeah, we are created love. Now, in this creation of love, God knows what is best for us. Who established the church? God. Yeah, Jesus Christ. Or, you know, don't call, please don't call Catholicism an organized religion. Oh, no. Well, I'm sorry to be an idealist at this point of time. I would say it is life. Yeah, God created it. You know, I'll give you an example. Maybe you understand it better. Does God change? You guys are so wonderful. I should have had you in a room. Yeah, and this digital is very complicated. Can you see me? Yeah.
Yeah.
God change?
No.
So an unchanging God communicating with, does man change?
Yes.
Internet, social media, this, that. Yeah, all kinds of changes. Technology, industrialization. Yeah. Generation X, Generation Z. Yeah. So an unchanging God trying to communicate with a changing man, just including woman, okay? Man and woman. Please, forgive me. You know, when the Bible says man, it's including woman. Yeah, equal rights. Don't sue me for this. So, God trying to communicate with an unchanging God, trying to communicate with a changing man and woman. Is this communication possible without a mediation? Absolutely impossible. You need to have the church. That's why an unchanging God trying to communicate with the changing mankind, there is the church that helps us to understand what God wants to tell us. You know, otherwise we will not survive. That's why Jesus knew it. That's why Jesus established the church before he went. Who established the church? Jesus established the church. And before he left, he had the apostles, the bishops ready. Why? Because he knew this is the only way that God could keep communicating with man. You know, I have some very interesting people in my life. I had this one youngster. He came and said, I am addicted to pornography. So I said, really? Why? He said, because in the Bible, there is no mention about pornography. I said, there was no internet during those times. So maybe I think you should look at an implication. He said, no. I said, so listen what the church has to say. If there was no church, you would be like, you would be doing so many things today. Are you with me? Yeah. So yeah. Without the church, how can you live? Because an unchanging God trying to communicate to a changing mankind. Every day, even the church today is coming and telling, trying to help us, like contraception, sexuality, so many things. Yeah. So all those who believe that I am going to be some great men and women believe that I am going to pray all by myself. I wake up in the morning and I'm going to pray all by myself. I will not go to a prayer meeting. I will not go to church. and I have a direct communication with God. You know, all those fools who say that, they actually have no communication with God. Because if they had communication with God, God would have told them, come on, get up and go to the church. You understand? So, yeah. Again, for anybody who wants to grow mature, spiritually mature, who wants to grow spiritually mature, he needs two types of spirituality. Personal spirituality and community spirituality. Are you with me? Yeah? If you are spiritually wrong, who would correct you? It's when you go to school, like Ellen said, that's when you know that 1 + 1 = 2. What if you sit alone and study mathematics and you start to believe that 1 + 1 = 3? You know, it is impossible to grow spiritually without a spiritual school. So all those, it is, you know, who is telling you all this? Satan. Satan doesn't want you to go to school. Satan wants you to sit alone and have a great time with him. Okay, sometimes the leaders of church do wrong. How can we trust the teachings of the church? Ah, amazing, amazing. I have now started getting, Jasmine, I'm sorry, I'm starting taking direct questions.
That's super. So the floor is now open. So if you guys want to ask any questions, you can type in the chat box or you can also send us personally and we can also ask as well. So it's, the floor is now open.
Okay.
Thank you, Peter, for the first question.
Okay. You know, I was a big judgmental person against church leaders. And I used to pass a lot of comments and do a lot of research about what they are doing is wrong. Okay. Till my brother became a priest. You know, my elder brother is a priest. So I know that church leadership, priesthood, being a bishop, being a holy father, being the pope, all these are calls just like we are called. We have an equal responsibility in the church. And they are all called in their own weaknesses. The church is never saying in its own teaching also that the church leaders are perfect. They are also just like us. Are you perfect? Can you be a perfect husband? No. Can you be a perfect child? Can you be a perfect son or a daughter? Try. You know? So that's why Jesus says, let the guy who is perfect throw the first stone. But that's not true about the teachings of the church. The teachings of the church are not out of one person's decision. That's a big wrong notion. Do you know that when the church passes a dogma, when the church passes anything as a teaching, do you know that so much of research and debate and discernment goes into that? It's not, you know, and Holy Father in many ways is just the representation of the Holy See, the College of Cardinals, who go through so much of brainstorming, so much of prayer and discernment before they say that something is something. Please understand. Don't think that, you know, that's why you need to understand the term called ex cathedra. Ex cathedra means from the chair, from the chair. That means when the Holy Father says something from the chair, it is infallible. But if the Holy Father wakes up in the morning and says, wow, what a beautiful morning, it does not mean that it's a beautiful morning. Or the Holy Father says, oh, you know what? I like Mercedes Benz over Volvo. It doesn't mean that Mercedes Benz is the best. Please understand. So don't try to compare church leadership to church teachings. Church leadership, weak human beings just like us, imperfect, trying to become perfect, make a lot of mistakes. But church teaching comes out of a lot of discernment, lot of what we can say, prayer. And, you know, it's not easy to pass something. Even to make somebody a saint, even to declare somebody a saint, the church goes through so much of anti-clockwise thinking. Do you know that? It's very difficult if you ask me, we can trust the church teachings. Now, can you trust the church leaders? Can you trust the church leaders? You know, I always ask this question. How many of you pray for your parish priest? How many pray for your bishop every day? You know, we have sometimes no right to judge them because we don't really pray for them. If you really pray for them, I'm sure that they would be a better person just like you are every day. Okay? So I'm not trying to justify all the mistakes that many of the church leaders might have done. But that does not mean that we just become judgmental and just try to say that everybody is wrong. Absolutely not. You see, there are, look at the ratio to how many lay people do what kind of creative sins every day. But when a few priests do something, we make a big issue out of it. They are also like us. Can you, okay, just because some of, I'll just ask you a question to the men. Just because some men made a mistake, should we eliminate all men? Just because some women made some mistake, can we say all women are wrong? I know we might be tempted to do that, but it's not true. No. Be careful. Gender, yeah? a lot of questions, okay. Why do government leaders take, why do government leaders break the law when they said that the people, why do government leaders break the laws when they said to the people, you can't do it? Well, I think it's a little out of scope for this program, but I still would like to take it because, I would just say that being good is a mutual activity. Are you with me? Yeah. Being good is not a singular activity. It has a plural always. I give an example. For example, when the leaders tell, if I am a leader of this group, I'll give you a good example and maybe you might know. Okay. But, hey, stop recording. Okay, Jaswin?
Yeah. Don't you... yeah.
Okay.
We are receiving a lot of questions. I think the next one on the list is from, maybe we can quickly comment on it, Chata, rather than spending too much time on it. Next one's from Alan. And Alan's asking about, people say God is infinite and he just wants to know, how is that possible?
Okay, I have a lot of other questions as well sent to me. Should I be taking everyone or the, which one? Okay, so which one do you want me to take? Jasmine, which one is relevant? There is God's will, free will, true Catholics can't be socialist. Which one? Why did God create people with disabilities?
I think, Jared, this is a good question. If God wants us to be holy, then why do we have freedom of choice? You won't always choose God's path. It's kind of connecting with what we were speaking at the start as well.
Okay. It's connected to what I was saying, but let me define holiness. Okay. What is holiness?
Love.
Can you be holy by yourself? Make yourself holy. You can't make yourself holy, yeah? What is holiness? Holiness is a gift from God. We should know that first, yeah? We cannot make ourselves holy, okay? So, if God wants to give us the gift of holiness, yeah? It's very important that we share in being the child of God. And in being the child of God, it is inevitable to have free will, okay? In our free will, we need to accept the holiness that God is giving us. So, if God takes away the free will, then we are not accepting this holiness as our choice. It is God's choice. Are you with me? Yeah. So, God actually wants us to partake, be part of the Trinitarian God's love where there is choice. Okay. I think we should thank God. We should not question God for it. I put the question, let's reverse the question. Why can't you accept God? You understand? Why can't you accept God? Why can't we follow God? Why can't we obey God? You see, saints have proven to us, the saints who lived before us, there were saints who were engineers, doctors, saints from all. There were saints who were 13, 14, who were teenagers like you. We have seen so many examples where if you give your free will to God, to the Holy Spirit, you will not sin. You will live holy lives. Then why? Why should we worry about free will? I think free will is a beautiful gift we should be happy about. We should be proud of. If you ask me two options, one is robotic life, robotic holiness, robotic spirituality, as opposed to childlike spirituality, childlike holiness, freedom of choice. Surely that's what the best thing God could have done for us. And he did the best thing for us. The only thing we need to do is accept it. There's nothing else we need to do. I would say God has given us, has made the right decision. God has given us the right path. It's only we who are not ready to accept it. And we are talking about a worst case scenario. We are talking about a worst case scenario where we would be like robots. What kind of theory, what kind of thinking is that? It's a very sad thinking. You understand what I'm saying? Yeah. It's like some people who say that they love their dogs. You know, do you really love your dogs? You know, would you love your dog if it bites you 3 times a day? Yeah. One after breakfast, after lunch, and after dinner. Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Would you keep that dog with you? No. You know, we have inferior theories that science that tells us that, you know, why not a robotic life? Science always going towards robotic life. God always going towards child, freedom of choice, love, powerful things. Man going into limitations, robotic, you know, would you create a robot and let it beat you every day? You know why? Because we are selfish. That's why we don't understand God. But God is not like that. God created us with the freedom of choice that you can beat him. That's what we are doing. Yeah, we are beating the pulp out of him. You see the cross. Yeah, that's love. What we have is selfishness. What God has is love. Don't make me emotional. You know, I get very emotional when this kind of theories and limitation theories come up.
Thank you so much, George. I think, you know, we should come to a conclusion. As you mentioned at the start, you know, a lot of the teens here in Ireland, we are very scared for our faith, and it's good to see so many questions coming up, but we were meant to finish at 1 o'clock and we're already 21 minutes past. But don't worry, next week we're going to have a similar kind of Q&A, so you can keep your questions and you can also let us know early as well, and we can definitely have them discussed. Today we are a bit short of time, so that's the only reason why we are concluding now. Thank you so much, George, for the way that you were with us and inspiring us, and for all the new insights that we received. I think, you know, as George mentioned at the start, we need to ask questions, we need to learn, and that's the only way that we're going to grow together. So thank you so much, George, on behalf of all of us here today. And it was a pleasure to have you on board.
Thank you, Jasmine. Thank you so much. And I love being with you. Yeah. I just want to end with one sentence. It's very simple because you had a lot of questions. It's very simple. It's what one small kid taught me. And I tell this to everybody I meet. I asked one small kid, he said that I am going to do great things for God. And I use science. You know, we are talking about science and God. And I use science and I told him, you are so small. Scientifically, you are so small. How can you do big things for God? And he had a very powerful answer, which a great theological answer. And I want to leave you with this thought. He said, when the big God comes into the small me, I do big things. So I hope and pray that we will have a childlike spirituality, a childlike seeking heart and mind, who loves the Father, believes the Father, and walks with the Father. So thank you. You guys are amazing. Yeah. God bless all of you.
Wow. Thank you. Thank you so much, George. So it was a very intense Q&A session, wasn't it? So I don't think it's fair enough to leave it at that. I think, you know, we have one last surprise for you guys. Since you guys asked so many questions, now I'm going to do the exact same thing. I'm going to ask you one question and let's see who knows the answer. If you know the answer, you can type it in the chat box and let's see who comes up with the answer first. So when you're ready, the question is, who was the first person to climb Mount Everest? Any response? Yeah, we're getting few in. Yes, that's right. And from my chat box, I can see Joel Rajesh was the first person. Yes, Edmund Hillary. And he also had a helper as well, Tenzing Norgay. So Edmund Hillary and Tenzing Norgay were the first people to climb Mount Everest back in 1953, back in an era where there was no Google Maps, no GPS. And I was recently reading about them, right? And in their journey, when they started climbing, they had many limitations. They had many challenges. At many times, they felt that this journey was not going to be possible. And at many times, they were tempted to abandon this dream, abandon this desire, and go back down. But every day, they kept continuing one step at a time. And the higher and higher they went, they were able to see a beauty that nobody else in the history of mankind has ever seen before. And I was thinking, wow, isn't that like our faith? Often in our journey as a Christian, as a Catholic, we go through so many challenges, so many limitations, and we feel like it's not worth it. It's worth pursuing. We should give up. But as we've seen in their story, if we make progress, persistence, and hopeful one day at a time, one step at a time, we begin to witness and see beauty in our life that we never seen before. And that's exactly what has happened in my own life, in the life of those around you as well. And definitely, we are not at the peak, but wouldn't that be great to one day reach the peak and say to Lord, yes, Lord, here I am. So with that thought, we're going to end today's webinar. As I said, we'll be coming up next week as well. So Thomas is here to fill us in what's coming up next week.
Oh, yeah. So guys, just to thank you all once again for coming. And Georgetta, thank you as well again for engaging like with us in such a fun way, but also like, you know, being open to take so many questions. So we really appreciate that. And we did actually have a lot of questions. So guys, so what we did was we had a survey out and it had a really good response. So what we tried to do was we tried to take similar questions, group them and, you know, ask them in groups. So we had about 10 or maybe 10 questions today, and we have a lot more to cover. So next week we'll be covering the rest of the questions that you guys have. So it will be on Saturday at 4 p.m. So hopefully that's it's a suitable time for all of you. And our speaker next week will be another resource from Kerala. Like his name is C.C. Joseph. It's just like George Eden. He'll be answering our questions next week. So thank you all again coming again for this week and for staying so long and for your questions. And see you all next week, and bring a friend as well, and invite your friends to if you guys enjoyed it, and to answer your questions and your friends' questions next week as well. And so also thank you all of you guys for joining for the prayer. Thank you everyone who led the prayer, and Jesslyn and Josna as well for leading the games and everything at the start. So Georgetta, thank you again once again, and we will all see you guys next week. Take care, guys.